Good morning, church. Good morning. I hope you're doing well this morning. I am excited to bring God's word to us today. You know, this is actually the first time that I am bringing God's word to all of our campuses, so welcome to all of our campuses. And you know, I was really eager to hear what passage would I be bringing from God's word to us today. What passage would the team ask me to preach and unpack for us? Would it maybe be on the wonderful healing power of Jesus? Would it be on one of the great parables? Would it be on God's love or his mercy or his goodness? No, it looks like I got and was given some of the easiest passages in Mark, the passages on the unforgivable sin. Just a light topic. Now, all joking aside, I love God's word. And I hope you love God's word too. And I love the easy passages in God's word, and I love the hard passages, the ones we have to wrestle through. And so I am excited to be diving into this difficult passage together today. And before we jump in, I want to give you a concept. And that concept is expectation versus reality. Expectation versus reality. And these two things are usually wildly different from one another. They're usually wildly different. The expectation, the thing that you've heard, or maybe the thing that you've seen, versus reality, the thing that's actually real. Expectation versus reality. And I brought some pictures of some real life examples of this. Expectation versus reality. Floats on water, expectation. Reality? No, it doesn't. Those are different. Here's another one. Travel expectations. The perfect picture. The reality, you can't see it. Oh, there it is at the bottom. Yeah, there's just a bunch of people doing this and totally missing it. It's reality. Here's the next one. Black Friday. It's coming up. The expectation, happy. I'm going to get all the things that I need to get. And then reality, chaos. Everywhere, chaos. Unless you go on Amazon. Amen. Here's another one. Snowmen. Oh, yes. The expectation of the perfect snowman. The reality... not quite. Or maybe this one. This one really speaks to me, really, like on a spiritual level. The expectation, yes, it's going to be beautiful, cuddling my children. The reality, and actually my reality, every single morning is a foot to the face. It's a great way to wake up. It's a great thing to see right in the morning, a smelly foot right in the face. Expectations versus reality. That's what we're going to see in the scriptures today. We're going to be in Mark chapter 3. We're going to be in verse 20, and we're going to be going all the way to verse 35. And we are continuing in our series in Mark called Just Jesus. And we're going to see this truth today. And we're going to see it, the reality of following Jesus. The reality of following Jesus. Not the expectation, not the thing that I've heard or I've heard about, but the real, what does it really look like to follow Jesus? What does the reality of following Jesus look like? And so before we jump in, let's pray. God, we are thankful for your word. Thankful that we can come here and open your word. God, I pray right now, as we begin to dive into this passage, Lord, that I would decrease and that you would increase. Lord, that you would be magnified through your word. And I pray, Lord, that you would give us wisdom to discern the truth of your word today as we dive in together. We pray all of these things in the wonderful and matchless name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. The reality of following Jesus. You see, Jesus had quite a couple of people following him at this time. He had the crowds who were following him. Maybe you've remembered that from the past weeks. There were many people, crowds that threatened to crush him. So many people were following Jesus. The disciples were also following Jesus as well. And then last week we talked about how Jesus called the apostles to a deeper level of followership in him. And I'm sure that they had expectations. I'm sure that they were told some pretty good things. That's why they're following Jesus right now. And I'm sure that they saw some pretty awesome things as well. And maybe during that time, they made this correlation. This is how it's always gonna be. It's always gonna be great. It's just gonna be healings and casting out demons and teaching and miracles. Nothing bad will ever happen. It's only going to be good. That's the expectation. But they are going to see some things happen and see some things happen to Jesus that will give them and us a bit of a reality check of what it looks like to follow Jesus. Here's the reality. Here's the first reality that we see in the passage. Jesus and his followers are misunderstood. Jesus and his followers are misunderstood. Look at verse 20 there. Then he came home, he went home, and the crowd gathered again so that they could not even eat. So after a long time of ministry and healing and calling the apostles, Jesus returns home. And this is most likely back at Peter's house in Capernaum. And just like before, the magnetism of Jesus is drawing this large crowd, this incredibly big crowd. This one is so large, in fact, that Jesus and his disciples were unable to eat. They were unable to eat. Imagine a house being that crowded. I mean, you thought your Thanksgiving was bad. Imagine this. You can't even lift your hand up to your mouth to eat. You can't even pass around plates. It is so crowded that you can't even eat. And when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, he is out of his mind. The word family here in the Greek literally means those of him. And it is meant to be simple and ambiguous. This most likely refers to his family, but it also could refer to his close friends as well. So they hear all that's going on. These crowds that are threatening to crush Jesus. The run-ins with the authorities, the religious elite. Their plots to destroy him, to get rid of him. They hear about all of these things. Now he's coming home. And they are beside themselves. They're like, here we go again. Typical Jesus. He comes home. He's back in town. He's probably not even resting. He's probably gonna make the religious leaders upset again, and they're gonna try and hurt him, or maybe even worse, kill him. And so his family, his close friends, they believe that he is, as the scripture says, out of his mind. They believe that he has gone crazy. The word there translated berserk. And they are going to seize him, to capture him, to bind him, to deprive him of his freedom. Why? Why would his family want to do this? Why would they think that he is out of his mind? It's because they thought that they knew what was best for him. They believed that they needed to save him from himself. What is he doing? What he's doing is crazy. It looks crazy. It sounds crazy. It feels crazy. We need to go and save Jesus from himself, which is a really ironic statement in and of itself. We are the ones, his family, his close friends, we're the ones who have his best intentions in mind. So let's go get him. Let's put a stop to this madness. Let's go tell him that he's being crazy. Now, these were the people who were closest to Jesus. These were his family, his friends. And yet, even though they were close to Jesus, they didn't understand him. They didn't understand him. They didn't understand his mission. They didn't understand what he was accomplishing. They didn't understand his ministry, his purpose. They didn't understand the way that he was living his life. It was too radical. It was too crazy. He needed to be saved. And listen, this is the reality of all of those who follow after Jesus. This is the reality of the disciples and the apostles, and this is the reality of us now. You will be misunderstood. I will be misunderstood. We will be misunderstood. And we will be misunderstood by those who are closest to us. And you know, the truth is that you really expect the enemy to come against you, don't you? You expect that. Of course, they don't like you. They're gonna come against you. You expect the enemy to do that. But the truth is, you don't really expect your family and your close friends to do the same. And the discouragement that is the hardest is not the discouragement that comes when the enemy attacks. It's when those closest to you do. That's what Jesus is encountering. That's what his disciples will encounter. And that is what you will, or maybe you already have, encountered as you follow after Jesus, being misunderstood. This is true in my life, and I remember so vividly the moment that the Lord called me to ministry. And I was working in Wisconsin at the time. I had just gotten done with college, and I had a good job. And I was making good money, and I felt the call to ministry. And I was actually driving from Wisconsin down to the Elgin campus at the time, and I was serving in the student ministry and on the worship team, and I was all in. I wanted to do ministry with my life. And so finally an opportunity came, and I got offered a position, a part-time position at the church. And so I said, Lord, listen, if I can crunch the numbers and if I can make this thing work, if I can just survive, I'll do it. I'll make the move. I'll go down there and I will go. And so I crunched the numbers, and wouldn't you know it, I was able to survive. Ramen and Easy Mac, that was what was in my future, but I was able to make it. And so I was so excited, I immediately called my work and I said, I'm putting my 2 weeks in. And then I went and told my parents. Now, of course, I told my mother first, and I went to my mom, and she is a wonderful believer of Jesus Christ and has really helped me grow my faith through my life. And so I told her, and of course she had all of the motherly questions, right? Are you gonna be okay? Are you gonna be able to make it? What are you gonna eat? Ramen's not good for you. And I'm like, it's fine, it's gonna be fine. And I told her, I can do it, I can survive. And I remember this. She looked me right in the eyes and she said, Tommy, I'm so proud of you for listening to the Lord's leading. And that was one of the most encouraging moments of my entire life. My mom saying that to me, she was proud of me. And then I told my dad. And I don't want my dad to look bad in this story at all. I love my father. He is a great man. He's a very big role model of mine. And the one thing is that he doesn't know the Lord. He doesn't know Jesus. And as you think about that this week, his name is Tom. That's why I'm Tommy. And if you could pray for his salvation, we've been praying for 27 years that he would be saved. And we still believe that the Lord's gonna do it. We believe that he's gonna draw him to himself and he's gonna save my dad. And so if you could pray for that, thank you for doing that. It means a lot to me. And so when I came and told him that I was leaving this job and I was going into part-time ministry, he said almost identically what's actually here in the passage. He said, Tommy, are you out of your mind? Have you lost it? What are you talking about? You have a job. You have a job that pays well. You could support a family with this. You could, if you save up just a little more, you could buy a house. What are you doing? You could be financially set. This is crazy. You are throwing your life away. I remember that statement. And I understood why my dad was saying all of this. Didn't come as a shock. I got it. He didn't understand. He didn't understand the reality of following after Jesus. He didn't have a framework for it. And so that's why he said those things. But I'd be lying to you if I said that they weren't discouraging to me. You see, every little boy's dream is to make their dad proud. And so to hear that was incredibly discouraging to me. And maybe you've experienced that before. As you followed after Jesus, you have experienced people misunderstanding you, and with that, discouragement comes. Maybe it's been your parents, maybe it's been your family, maybe it's been your closest friends, but they misunderstood you. They thought you were crazy. They thought that you've gone off the deep end. Why do you spend so much of your time at church? Why are you always going around having awkward conversations about Jesus to random people? Why do you go and raise your hands in worship and look like a complete fool in front of other people? Why do you constantly give grace and mercy to those who deserve harsh judgment? Why do you pray for those you should hate? Why do you love those who are hardest to love? Why do you help those who are never going to thank you? Why do you serve those who are never going to appreciate it? Why do you give time to those who aren't worth it? Why do you speak to those who aren't really listening to you? Why do you read a book and base your life on something that was written 2,000 years ago? Why do you give your life to a fairy tale, a myth? Why do you give your hard-earned money away? They can't understand what is happening. They can't understand what's happening. The way that Jesus and his followers lived and how you are to live as a follower of Christ is radical to those who aren't on mission. Let me say that again. The way that Jesus and his followers lived and how you are to live as a follower of Christ is radical to those who are not on mission. And maybe you're sitting there and you're sitting in your seat and you're thinking, well, Pastor Tommy, that doesn't really happen to me. I've never really experienced that before. Well, if that's true, and you don't hear or feel this type of treatment from those around you, maybe, just maybe, you're not living this radical life, this misunderstood life of following after Jesus. Maybe you're stuck on the sidelines and you're watching other people live this life. Maybe your life looks like this instead. I call it the understandable life. It's the understandable life. You choose comfort. What is easiest and most comfortable is always going to be my top priority. A situation comes to me, it goes into my head, the equation starts, and if it equals uncomfortable, I don't do it. I'm choosing comfort. I'm choosing what is easiest. That's understandable. Maybe you choose complaining. Maybe you choose complaining. I'll critique rather than help. I'll stand on the sidelines and I will shout criticism instead of actually rolling up my sleeves and jumping in and helping. I'll complain. That's understandable. You choose conditional. How you treat me is how I'm going to treat you. If you love me, I'm gonna love you. If you forgive me, I'm gonna forgive you. If you're mean to me, I'm gonna be mean to you. If you stop loving me, I'm gonna stop loving you. If you stop forgiving me, I'm gonna stop forgiving you. It's conditional. It's understandable. Maybe you choose conservation. Maybe you choose conservation. What won't hurt me the most? If this decision, if this choice, if this behavior is going to cause me to feel some pain, if this is gonna suffer loss in my life, if I'm gonna have to sacrifice to do that, I'm not doing that. I'm choosing conservation. What won't hurt me the most? Maybe you choose conventional. What does the world do? What does the majority do? That's how I'm going to do it. I go with the flow. What's the majority? How do they behave? How do they act? What do they do? That's what I'm gonna do. I'm not gonna turn around and rub up against the majority. I'm not gonna become the minority. I'm not gonna be countercultural. I'm gonna go with the flow. I'm gonna be a normal person. I'm gonna be conventional. And this is a very understandable life, isn't it, to the world? They say, of course, you're looking out for yourself. You're looking out for you. That's understandable. I can understand that. But when we start living the life that truly follows after Jesus, the radical and the misunderstood life, people will truly start to not understand you at all. And let me tell you, they will tell you. They will come up to you and they will say, I don't understand you. You're crazy. Because that's the reality of following Jesus. A reality of following Jesus is that Jesus and his followers are misunderstood, and you will be misunderstood as well. Here's another reality we see in the text. Jesus and his followers are opposed. Jesus and his followers are opposed. Look at verse 22 with me. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, he is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of demons he casts out demons. It makes a special note here that these scribes came from Jerusalem. Now, these weren't just your everyday scribes. These were super scribes, all right? They were from Jerusalem. They were from the epicenter of learning and scholarship in Jewish law. These guys were the real deal. These were the scribes from Jerusalem. And they'd been hearing about this Jesus guy. They'd been hearing about him. And so they ventured out from Jerusalem and went to where Jesus was in Capernaum, which, by the way, is a 34-hour walk, about four-day journey. And they went up to where Jesus was so that they could observe him and so that they could confront this man of God that they've heard about. And after seeing the miracles, and after hearing his teaching, and after seeing him cast out demons, seeing these wonderful and beautiful acts of the divine, this is the conclusion that they came to, that he is possessed by Beelzebul. Now, maybe you're sitting there and you're like, what is Beelzebul? What does that mean? What on earth does that mean? Well, simply, it had become a name for Satan. And it likely came from the word Beelzebub, which meant Baal of the high place or Lord of the high place, lowercase l. And this was a false god, lowercase g, Beelzebub. And so the Jewish people corrupted the word Beelzebub and changed it into Beelzebul, okay? They changed the last letter of the word from a B to an L. And when you do that, you change the meaning of the word. Beelzebub, which means the Lord of the high place, when you change the last letter to an L, it means the Lord of the manure, right? That's a really nice diss by the Jewish people to this false god. It's a very creative way to throw some shade at a false god. And so, I mean, you can take the pastor out of the student ministry, but you really can't take the student ministry out of the pastor. And so I have a special place in my heart for really good manure jokes. And I love this. I love that they corrupted the word. But here's the bad thing, is The conclusion that they're coming to is that Jesus is possessed by a demon. And by the prince of demons, he casts out other demons. Why would they say that? How could they possibly come to that conclusion after seeing him and what he's been doing? How could they come to this conclusion? Well, there's a popular argument that has been around for a very long time. It started by a man named John Duncan, and it was later refined by a man named Watchman Nee, and then it was further refined on top of that by a man named C.S. Lewis. And maybe you've heard this argument before. It's called lunatic, liar, or Lord. And I think Watchman Nee really puts it together very succinctly for us. Here's his quote. First, if he claims to be God and yet in fact is not, he has to be a madman or a lunatic. Second, if he is neither God nor a lunatic, he has to be a liar, deceiving others by his lie. Third, if he is neither of these, he must be God. You can only choose one of three possibilities. If you do not believe that he is God, you have to consider him a madman. If you cannot take him for either of the two, you have to take him for a liar. There is no need for us to prove if Jesus of Nazareth is God or not. All we have to do is find out if he is a lunatic or a liar. If he is neither, he must be the Son of God. And so these scribes, they have come face to face with Jesus. They have seen his supernatural miracles. And so they're like, well, okay, he can't be a lunatic. Because a lunatic is just a madman with no power. We're witnessing this man do supernatural miracles. And he's not a liar because we're witnessing it with our very eyes and we're hearing this irrefutable truth of God that he's speaking and teaching. And so instead of coming to the natural conclusion of that then and coming to the conclusion that he is Lord, they go the opposite way. This must be the work of Satan. Now, whether this was self-righteousness in them, whether this was self-preservation in them, whether this was pride in them, they started to go on a smear campaign against Jesus. And they were saying, listen, he's not divine, he is demonic. And by the demonic powers, he's doing all of these things. This is opposition. These religious elites were opposing Jesus Christ, and they were calling him demonic. You see, Jesus is risky to them. Jesus is dangerous to them. Jesus is an enigma to them. Jesus is misunderstood by them. And so they oppose him and his radical life and miracles and teaching, which also means that they oppose his followers as well. And this is true today. If you live a life that is following after Jesus in the radical ways that he did ministry and according to his word, you will face opposition. Let me say that again. If you live a life that is following after Jesus in the radical ways that he did ministry and according to his word, you will face opposition. That truth has not faded with time. We see it happening all over the world. Christians are being opposed. Christians are being persecuted. Christians are even being killed because they follow Jesus Christ. And we see that overseas more so than we see it here in the United States. But we are seeing a big cultural shift in the U.S. right now. The ideals, the moralities, the lifestyle, the teaching of Jesus, and thus the follower are being opposed at every turn. In legislation, opposition. In businesses, opposition. In schools across America, opposition. In ideologies, opposition. Jesus and his followers are being opposed. You will face opposition as a follower of Jesus Christ. That is a reality of following after him. And so the natural question is, well, what do I do if I face opposition? What do I do? Opposition's gonna come. How do I respond to opposition? What do I do? Well, simply, you do what Jesus does. Now, Jesus faces a lot of opposition. He faces a lot of opposition, mostly from the religious leaders. And he responds very specifically in this case. And I think there's a lot that we can learn from Jesus' response to this opposition. Here's the first thing that I see. Jesus is intentional. When opposition comes your way, be intentional. Jesus is intentional. Look at verse 23. It says, and he called them, the scribes, he called them to him. He called them to him. I love what Jesus does. He hears what's going on and he intentionally calls them forward. He's like, guys, I hear you. Come here. Let me tell you something. And he confronts them for sure. but he's intentional in it, and he's gentle. Come forward, come here. I need to tell you something. This is really countercultural, right? If someone was putting a smear campaign against you, the world says, dismiss them, label them, berate them, cancel them, blast them. Why doesn't Jesus just go off on them? Why doesn't he just crush them? Why doesn't he point at them, embarrass them, and make them leave? Because Jesus is intentional, and Jesus is gentle. And he intentionally confronts them in a gentle way, calling them to himself. Come here, I want to tell you something. And here's the next thing that we see. Jesus responds. Jesus is rational. Jesus is rational. He calls them close, and instead of being ruled by emotions and lashing out or becoming uncontrollable in his anger, he's rational. And he sets forth a rational and logical argument against them. Breaks it up into two parts. The first part we see in 23b, go ahead and look there. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. Yes, Abraham Lincoln was quoting Jesus in his famous speech. Verse 26, and if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. Jesus is using an argument here. It's called reduction to absurdity. Reduction to absurdity. How can Satan cast out Satan? That's absurd. He would be destroying his own kingdom. Why would he do that? Why would he be healing these demon-possessed people? These are his soldiers. These soldiers who their job is to cause destruction. Why would he nullify that? If that's actually happening and Satan is attacking himself, then surely he's going to come to an end. A house divided against itself cannot stand. So that would be absurd. Satan does not want to destroy his own work. Satan wants to destroy the work of God. Absurd. He goes on, verse 27. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed he may plunder his house. This is called something, it's called a logical statement. If you want to steal a man's goods, you first need to bind him. I mean, he's not going to let you just come in and steal his stuff. You have to be stronger than that man to bind him as well. And so in this example, the strong man is Satan, and Jesus is the one who is stronger than the strong man. And Jesus in this statement is saying, I am stronger than Satan. I'm plundering his goods. I'm stealing from his house. I am destroying his work. I, Jesus, am stronger than Satan. And scribes, who's the only one stronger than Satan? God. Logical statement. I love that Jesus is rational. He's intentional, he's rational, and then this, Jesus is truth. Jesus is truth. Verse 28, truly I say to you, anytime Jesus starts a sentence off like that, truly, truly, truly I say to you, there is truth coming, all right? Truly I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man and whatever blasphemies they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. Jesus answers with truth, divine truth, hard truth, scary truth, but it's truth. Jesus responds to these scribes with absolute truth. Now, that is a verse, right? That is a verse, so let's unpack it. This is the scary verse of the passage, right? Maybe you've read this before, maybe this is the first time you're hearing it and you're afraid. If I blaspheme the Holy Spirit, I can never be forgiven. I can never have forgiveness. What that means here, when it says never have forgiveness, it means in this age or the age to come, never have forgiveness. And so this verse starts you down a road of questions, right? Have I ever done this? Have I ever committed this sin, maybe by accident, and I can't be forgiven? Will I ever do this in the future? Will I commit this sin? Maybe by accident, I won't have forgiveness in this age or the age to come. It's a scary verse. Start asking some scary questions. Let me bring some comfort to your heart today. This is a very unique sin. This is a very unique sin. And it cannot be replicated today. It cannot be replicated today. Let me break this down. Jesus is speaking to the scribes. He calls them in close. He is speaking directly to them. This is what he's saying to these scribes. These scribes have seen the irrefutable miracles that Jesus was performing through the Holy Spirit. They have heard the irrefutable truth of God that Jesus was teaching. They experienced the fullness of Jesus face to face. The Messiah, the one who was fulfilling the prophecies of the Old Testament. They saw it all. And despite seeing the fullness of Jesus and the Holy Spirit at work in him, God in human form, they attribute his works, teaching, and miracles to the demonic. That is the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. With full enlightenment of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit at work, they came to the conclusion that it is not divine, it is demonic. And that is unforgivable. Now, the reason that it is not repeatable today is because Jesus no longer is on the earth physically with us. We can't witness him face to face performing these miracles and healings and teachings in the same way as these scribes did. We don't have the same full enlightenment that these scribes had and then rejected him and claimed that his work was not only crazy, but that it was demonic. We don't have that anymore. And I think Mark kind of sees the confusion that might come from this text. And in one of the few occasions, Mark gives a little bit of clarity after Jesus says something. He doesn't do that very much in the book of Mark, but after this one, he's like, maybe I'll just put this one in. Verse 30, for they were saying, why did Jesus say this? For they were saying, the scribes, he has an unclean spirit. It's specific. Now, some would say that the only unforgivable sin that is still in existence today is the sin of continued unbelief, dying without ever believing that Jesus is Lord and Savior. And technically, that's true, right? If you die without believing in Jesus, you cannot have forgiveness. This is our one and only chance to make the decision, our one and only life to make the decision to believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We don't get a second chance after death. And so in the technical sense, yes, that is unforgivable because you can't go back and do it again. But I'm very cautious to say that unbelief in any form, especially while we're still living, every person in this room right now is living. Everyone is living right now. And I am very cautious to say unbelief is unforgivable at this moment. Because the reality is that you have at some point in your life been guilty of continued unbelief. You have. You have continuously unbelieved in Jesus for however long it took until you made that decision. And the reality is that you could, your whole life, from when you're born to whatever age you are right now, you have continued in unbelief against Jesus. And in this moment, right now, you can come to him and you can believe that Jesus is Lord and Savior, and he will save you and he will forgive you from that continued unbelief. So I'm very cautious to call it the unforgivable sin. I like to call it the unforgiven sin. It becomes unforgivable after you die, sure. But right now, as we're living, it's unforgiven. I think that's more helpful to us as we read this. And so that's a really long way of saying no. If you've asked that question, can I commit this? Have I committed this? Will I commit this? You have not. You cannot commit this specific sin today. And the truth is that Satan would like nothing more for you than for you to believe that. He wants you to be in fear. So be encouraged. Take heart. You have not committed the unforgivable sin. Because Jesus promised to us in Scripture is this, that he is able to save completely those who come to God through him. That's Hebrews 7:25. Let me read that again. He is able, Jesus is able to save completely. Say completely. 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 Those who come to God through him. And listen, Jesus never fails. Amen. He never fails. And he is able to save completely those who come to him, come to God through him. And he never, ever fails. And so the reality of the Christian life is that you will face misunderstanding and you will face opposition. Here's another reality of following Jesus. This is the last point. The reality is that Jesus and his followers form a new family. Look at verse 31. And his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. And a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, mother and brothers are outside seeking you. And he answered them, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking about at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. Here's the conclusion of verse 20, when his family went out to seize him. Now we're here in verse 31, and they arrived. In verse 20, they went out. Verse 31, they are arriving. It's kind of like this. This is what the Bible is doing, right? Verse 20, then some stuff happens. I'm gonna leave this in the bag because it'll smell bad. And now here we are. Verse 31, the Bible is making, boom, a scripture sandwich. It's delicious, I'm not gonna eat that. I just got crumbs all over my notes. It's a scripture sandwich. They left, now they're here, and they're calling to Jesus. And the crowd was too large. It was way too big for them to get inside and to get close to Jesus. So outside they called him, trying to exercise some authority over Jesus. And the message makes its way to Jesus, and then he says this really strange thing. He says, who are my mother and who are my brothers? Now obviously Jesus did not get amnesia. I mean, he knows who his mother and his brothers are. He's about to make a statement. He's about to make a very profound statement. He says, here, those who are sitting around me, here, behold, these are my mother and brothers. For whoever does the will of God, those are my brothers. Those are my sisters. Those are my mother. Jesus is upsetting the cultural and established norms of the family right now. Jesus is pronouncing a new family for himself. One that is disregarding his natural physical family, which is very important at the time, and is forming a new spiritual family. Do you see it happening right here? And what he's saying is he's saying that this spiritual family is on a higher level even than the earthly family that he has. He is showing that this new spiritual family of brothers and sisters and mothers are as dear to him and even more so than his family according to the flesh. He says, this is my family. This family. And this family right here is more important to me than even my own family according to the flesh who are outside right now. I love in this is that he says, for whoever, I want you to remember that word, whoever does the will of God. What is the will of God? What is that? Well, it certainly is believing in Jesus Christ as your Savior, as your Lord. That is for sure the will of God. But it is also hearing the word of God and doing it. It's hearing the word of God and doing it. That is the will of God. And so all that do the will of God, all who hear the word of God and do it, all who believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, they will become a part of this new spiritual family. And let me tell you, it is an amazing family to be a part of. And those of you who are in this family, in this room, across our campuses, you know this family is awesome. This family is incredible. And God has a lot to say about this family. And he shows us some benefits of this family. And you know what? I wrote down just a couple of benefits. It's for sure not an exhaustive list by any means, but these are some of the benefits of being a part of Jesus' family. This is in God's word. You are beloved. You are forgiven. You are free. You are righteous. You are new. You are a child of God. You are a saint. You are never alone. You are a masterpiece. You are wonderfully made. You are bold. You are delighted in. You are a co-heir with Christ. You are set apart. You are given a new purpose. You are a temple of the Holy Spirit. You are given victory. You are made whole. You are a sweet aroma. That's awesome. You are part of a new spiritual family. Whoever does the will of God. You see, the reality of following Jesus is that it's difficult, but it's completely worth it. The reality of following Jesus is that it is difficult. You will be misunderstood. You will face opposition. You will have trial and tribulation, but the reality is also that it is worth it completely, 100%. 10 out of 10 would do again. The reality of following Jesus is that it's hard, but it is worth it every time. And I don't want to miss the invitation that the text has for us in here, that Jesus has in this text, right at the end. Remember the word I told you to remember, whoever. That's an invitation. And I know that many of us in this room are probably already a part of this amazing new spiritual family that Jesus has put together. But the reality is that there might be someone who is sitting in the seats across our campuses who hasn't made that decision yet, who hasn't become a part of this incredible spiritual family. And after being illuminated to who Jesus is, you want to put your faith and trust in him. You want to be a part of this new spiritual family. You want to go from unbelief to belief. It's for whoever does the will of God, whoever. That's you. You can be that whoever right now. Jesus is inviting you. Whoever. That could be you right in this moment. And I want to give you the opportunity to respond in faith to that. I want to give you the opportunity to respond in faith to Jesus' invitation. For whoever does the will of God is a part of my family. Whoever believes in me, believes that I am Lord and Savior and does the will of God, hears the word and does it, that person will be saved, be part of this family. And so I would just ask you to do something in faith, nothing crazy, but as a symbol to say, I'm going from unbelief, I am believing in Jesus Christ. I'm not wasting this one and only life continuing to unbelieve. I am going to believe that Jesus is Lord. And as a symbol of that faith, I just want you to go ahead across all of our campuses, just raise your hand. Just raise it high too. Say, I want to give my life to the Lord. Keep it up. I want to pray for you. And I want us to pray for you as well. And so if you're by someone who has their hand in the air, go ahead and put your hand on their shoulder. If you're not close to them, just reach your hand out to them. And let's pray. God, we come before you. We are celebrating. We are celebrating, Lord, adding new members to your spiritual family. We know that the angels in heaven are rejoicing right now. There's a celebration happening in heaven for those who have joined this family, who have gone from unbelief to belief in your Son, Jesus Christ. He is Lord. And we proclaim that here in this place. He is Lord. He is Savior. Lord, we acknowledge that we are sinners and that you are our Savior. Encourage their hearts. Encourage them now, Lord. Let them feel the forgiveness that they have in you, the weight of sin lifted off of them. What a wonderful gift that is. Lord, we're thankful for each and every one of them for responding in faith to come to you, to receive your invitation, whoever. We pray all of this in the strong name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Well, listen, maybe you're here and you've been a part of this spiritual family, but maybe you want to go deeper. You want to go deeper in obedience. You want to go deeper in devotion. You want to go deeper into application of God's word. I want to give you the opportunity to respond in faith right now as well. Putting a stake in the ground, saying, I'm all in. I'm done living the comfortable life. I'm done living the understandable life. I want to live the radical life. I want to live the misunderstood life of following after Jesus. That's the life that I want to live. I want to go deeper in obedience and devotion and application of God's word. And listen, if that's you, if you want to go deeper, if you want to be all in, if you want to be radical and misunderstood for Jesus Christ, if you want to make that decision, I want you to raise your hand right now in faith. Just go ahead, raise them up all across our campuses. I want to go deeper. I want to pray for you as well. And now, if you have someone who's, again, by you with their hand up, go ahead and put your hand on their shoulder. or extend your hand towards them. We're gonna pray right now. God, we come before you thankful for the decisions made in faith right now. God, I pray that all who have raised their hands wanting to go deeper with you, Lord, that you would grant them that. That even now they would be feeling your presence so near to them. Because, Lord, your word tells us that if we draw near to you, you will draw near to us. And those that are here have drawn near to you. And you are drawing near to them right now. And so, Lord, I pray for faith. I pray for strength. We cannot do this radical, misunderstood life without you and without your Spirit. And so, Lord, fill us, help us, strengthen us to live the radical life, the misunderstood life. Lord, we want to be misunderstood. We want to be opposed. Because even though it's hard, it's worth it. It is so worth it, Lord. Thank you for our time in your word today. Thank you for the decisions made. God, we give this all to you. You're so faithful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.